Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane.
We borrowed the Christmas tree from Germany and the Christmas card from England. But one Christmas icon was developed right here in America, Santa Claus.
Hang your stocking, say your prayers, for Santa Claus comes tonight.
Long before Santa, however, there was Saint Nicholas, a Greek Orthodox bishop who became one of the most popular saints of the Middle Ages. On December 6th, St. Nicholas Day, good children woke to gifts from the kindly saint. Bad children sulked away with nothing. In Holland, he was known as Sinterklaas, and when the Dutch came to this country, they brought tales of their gift-giving Nicholas with them. This quaint custom caught the imagination of Clement Clark Moore, a well-heeled Episcopal minister in New York City. In 1822, Moore wrote a poem for his children about a good-natured saint who came down the chimney on Christmas Eve.
"'Twas the night before Christmas, and all through the house not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that St. Nicholas would soon be there."
Moore dreamed up Dasher, Dancer, and the rest of the reindeer, along with Santa's entrance through the chimney. But at first he was embarrassed by the poem. He worried it was too frivolous for a man of the church.
Clement Moore was a minister. Here a minister, who should be on the other side, is promoting a secular Christmas with reindeer and all the rest of it. But it was no mention in the poem of anything religious. And in fact, that's why he didn't reveal who he was. In the beginning, he didn't reveal the authorship.
Moore soon owned up to the poem when it became clear that every child in America was scanning the horizon for reindeer on Christmas Eve. Less clear was what exactly this Santa Claus looked like. At first, Santa came in all shapes and sizes. A pagan sorcerer, a frightening gnome, even a drunkard on a turkey-driven sleigh. Then, in 1863, Thomas Nast, a cartoonist for Harper's Weekly, settled the matter once and for all with his version of the Christmas saint. Nast Santa was rounder and jollier than his austere Catholic cousin. He looked, in fact, like a man of his times, a man who would fit right in with the rotund, bewhiskered robber barons of the late 19th century. But Santa was a robber baron in reverse.
Instead of taking from the less fortunate, he gave to the less fortunate. He gave to people regardless of whether they'd done something or not. In other words, he gave to children. Instead of gathering together wealth, he gets rid of wealth, and he does it yearly.
A captain of industry with a heart of gold. It's no wonder that by the 1840s, Santa Claus was an irresistible image to America's retailers. Here was a guy who could sell anything at Christmas, but make it seem like you were not buying gifts at all.
Santa Claus provided a way for both children and parents to pretend that Christmas presents were not in the realm of the commercial marketplace, that Christmas presents existed in the realm of pure domestic affection. So Santa Claus played a very important role for both parents and children. He took presents out of the realm of commerce.
If the image of Santa could sell merchandise, retailers soon figured that a real-life Santa would boost sales even further. Santa has been showing up in department stores since the mid-1800s. And since then, nothing has loomed larger to a child at Christmas than this annual pilgrimage.
If you want to talk to Santa Claus, where do you go? You go to the shopping mall. Now, this is strange for a saint to be living pretty much full-time in a department store. It doesn't bother Americans, because we are, after all, a capitalistic society. It makes perfect sense for us to have our national saint in a department store. That's commercial sense for us, dollars and cents.
Author and humorist Gene Shepherd immortalized this rite of passage in A Christmas Story, an autobiographical account of one boy's Christmas.
You know, I'd been thinking for weeks what I wanted for Christmas. I figured the best thing to do is to tell Santa Claus about that. And I looked up at that Santa Claus, and he had these big, watery blue eyes and a huge beard and all, and he's looking at me right in the eye. And he was so impressive that my mind went blank.
Then what's your name, little boy?
It's like if all of a sudden you're sitting on the president's lap, and he says, "What would you like me to pass in legislation, sonny?" I mean, your mind's going to go blank. You can't remember any of this stuff. And so at that point, Santa Claus looked at me and he says, "All right, how about a football, kid?"
"How about a nice football?"
A football. I wanted a BB gun. So he pushed me off his lap, and this elf grabbed me and threw me down a slide that went down into the snow. And I laid there for a minute, and I knew that I was not a fit person to talk to the great. Santa Claus was obviously a star.
A celebrity of this magnitude obviously needed a sidekick. In 1939, Robert May, a copywriter at the Montgomery Ward department store, dashed off a promotional children's book to lure Christmas shoppers into the store. May's story told of an ostracized reindeer with a big red nose.
Poor Rudolph. Where most reindeer's noses are brownish and tiny, Rudolph's was red, very large, and quite shiny.
This physical, shall I say, disability turns out to be an asset because it's a foggy Christmas Eve.
This fog would be hard to get through.
And this light on the nose enables poor old stumbling Santa Claus to get through.
Then how the reindeer loved him as they shouted out with glee. Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer, you'll go down in history.
So you have this handicapped sort of child figure helping the benighted parental figure make Christmas possible.
Rudolph brought Christmas full circle. It was now the children who really made Christmas possible. Only they understood the meaning of this enchanted day. From Washington Irving to Montgomery Ward, a battle for Christmas had been fought and won by kids.